Oh, yeah. You know, we've been doing this show. This is our 9th episode now, and I am so freaking excited for this episode. It's not funny. Welcome to Live Streams with Famous Friends. I am your host, Jason McNamara, and sitting over here in Napier in New Zealand is my dear friend, Mr. David Birch. I'm going to poke him in the eyes. Here we go. You ready? You ready, Dave? You ready?
Yeah.
Yeah, a bit of a delay. That gag so didn't work.
It didn't work at all. I didn't even see what was going on. So, you know, not only did it not work, I had no idea what was going on.
Exactly. And anyway, look, I could sit here and faff around for a while, but I don't want to take too long because I'm so excited to talk to these guys. I've been a fan of this band since their actual debut, like the moment that they debuted. I saw them. I'm going to do this while they're on air. I'm not going to screw around anymore. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Suze DeMarchi and Dave Leslie from the Baby Animals.
Hey!
Yay!
We're wired already. How you going, folks?
Great. I'm good. How are you?
You know what? I really am as excited as I'm saying. Like, you have no idea. So here's the setup for you. We look back to, I can't remember the exact date, all right? But I definitively, you know, you have those moments where a band comes on your radar and you actually remember the moment, like you were sitting next to yourself, watching yourself, remembering the moment that definitive thing happened. You get what I'm getting at here?
Yeah.
My moment of discovering your band was on that show, Tonight Live with Steve Vizard. I was watching the episode where you guys got up and you did Early Warning. And as soon as it kicked in, I mean, for those of you at home, because I know there's people watching the show who aren't necessarily overly familiar with the band, because I've pushed the hell out of this thing, and there are plenty of you who know the band really well. When you're sitting at home, and let me think, was it 1990 you guys did the show?
I have no idea. I don't even remember doing that show.
Really? Yeah. That's funny.
Dan? I remember doing it, yeah. I remember I wore some purple velvet pants.
Wow, he remembers everything.
I think mainly the 90, because we formed in 89, so it may have been 91.
Oh yeah, actually, that sounds right.
Late 90, because we recorded over sort of late 90, early 91 sort of thing, over that Christmas New Year period. So it would have been 91, yeah.
So I'm sitting there, and if it was 91, I was 19. And I was watching it, and I loved rock music like most of us do at that age. And then this kicks in. And instantly, I was like, wow, an Australian band with this much balls, hell yeah. And then this voice. Too young and not too old to listen. And I was just like, holy shit, it knocked me on my ass. Like, it absolutely, totally and utterly floored me. And then, like most guys in Australia, I just fell in love with Suze on the spot. Like, the amount of friends who've reached out to me and told me, man, I had the biggest crush on Suze. It was just insane. Like, man.
Guilty.
So, put it all together between the quality of the musicians in the band. I mean, that was the thing that really grabbed me. Like, no offense, mate, but you became secondary once I got to discovering how freaking awesome the musicianship in the band was, and that was what grabbed me. And the thing I loved about the early 90s in Australia is in the 70s and 80s, we had really cool songwriting and really cool stuff going on. Obviously, the guys in Chisel were great players, and we'll get to Dave's connection to that in a minute. But what I dug was suddenly the Southern Suns popped up, and they're shredding like no man's business, and Virgil Donati going apeshit on the drums. Screaming Jets popped up with that little bit more bite and edge than what the Aussie bands had had. Roxas were doing it a little bit more sort of rock style, like the American type of style. Chocolate Starfish were doing a similar thing. I mean, they were an offshoot of Roxas anyway. And you guys, and like those five bands, I was like, wow, the higher gain, the heavier drums and the big production that I really loved that the American bands were doing was being imported into Australia with that classic Zeppelin type of a feel, but with the Aussie flavor still going. And that's why it really grabbed me at that particular age. And that's why to this day, I still listen to those first two albums consistently.
Yeah.
I'm torn between which is my favorite, because I know that unfortunately you guys were I don't know. I can't use your words, but I assume would be probably disappointed by the way that the second album wasn't embraced like the first one. But for me personally, I can tell you right now, Shaved and Dangerous is just right up there on my Desert Island albums. Love that record.
Captain Dangerous is a real Muso's record. It's not, yeah, we got a little bit, yeah. I do love that record. You know, I'm not surprised that it didn't do as well as the first one, because it was a little more it was less poppy, you know, and it was a more complicated record and
harder to dance to,
exactly. So yep. It's fine. I mean, you know, we also the sound of those records was primarily, you know, we recorded them at Bearsville. Both of them, we did the live tracks, you know, like drums, and the beds of the album were both at Bearsville in New York. And that big live, they've got a big live, well, they had, it's gone now, but wooden live room, that everything that you hear from that studio sounds massive. And so, and, you know, had a lot to do with that, and had a lot to do with Kevin Shirley. And also we had an idea of how we wanted the record to sound when we went in, before we went in. We loved that kind of fat sounding Bonamy drums and the, yeah. You know, obviously everybody loved that stuff, but
still do. You know,
yeah, of course. So,
There is a slight sonic difference between the two records. Not that there's anything bad in that. To give the listeners a quick reference, because I know some people never moved past the first album. That's just the way it is. If I replay right now quickly, this is the intro one more time for early warning, so you can hear the difference in the drum sound particularly, because what Susie's referring to is exactly right. Here's the early warning intro one more time. And then when you go to the second album for Shaved and Dangerous and you have a listen to the opening of Backbone, here's the sound of that. I love that little
Lego.
Was that your idea or was that one of the others? The button.
Oh, it was mine. Yeah, that was mine.
Because I love it, so she's getting to claim it.
I must admit, being a drummer and that intro to the start of Shaved and Dangerous, that's just like, yeah.
Yeah.
And, yeah, what a huge sound. So, yeah, really, it that drew me in immediately. And then from there, I just fell in love with what you guys do. And your songwriting is incredible. It's really, really cool. And I still see that you guys are still obviously writing songs together and still jamming together, which is really, really exciting.
We are. If nothing, we're not, prolific.
That is one way to term it.
But we are. We did a third record, but when we reformed, but we're also working on a new record now. But, the whole landscape has changed since we first started making records, and when we had a label and we had, you know, the finances to make a record, and you could take your time to make a record and you could do it in a, you know, nice studio. And
yeah,
we're sort of from that era. I mean, we do a lot of work in living rooms too. You know, Dave and I did a lot of the third record just writing it in his kitchen, you know. And but I think we do like the idea of doing a record in a nice big sounding room and studio, and having the luxury of you know, spending time on a song is sort of, it's a luxury now. And
yeah,
I don't think we realized at the time how lucky we were to have that luxury so back, you know, early on in our career. But it makes it hard to actually kind of change your ways to figure out the new ways of doing it. But
going from that completely organic, all in the one room, creating amazing sonicness to where we can now email stems to each other and just, you know, put an album together remotely, it's definitely a totally different world we live in. So
it is. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I love it that much. I'd rather be in a room with everyone.
Yeah, you get that vibe. You get to start to feel what's going on there, so it does make it a lot more enjoyable.
I think it's important. I think it's different if you're an electronic band or if you're a duo or if you're from that world, and that's fine and that works really well for a lot of artists. But Yeah, I really like the idea for me of being in a band is all about being in a room with a bunch of people that you love, that you want to hang out with and make music with. There's
and
sort
you
of
can
a
so hear the sound of that in those first few shows.
You also have to want to be able to be in a van with them for hours and hours and hours.
Yes.
And that's the other part of it is like, I mean, I ask these things as a fan and also as somebody who's obviously trying to help fans out there get the questions answered. Without going into the dirt side of things, is there a story behind why Frank and Eddie just it's not gelling and what have you? Because I got to say, I've seen you guys the last time I saw you, because I've been living in Japan now, it's been a while. The last time I saw you was at the Prince's Ballroom in Melbourne. And I can't remember who your bass player and drummer were at that time, but it would have been 2010, I would say, maybe 2011. It just has a different feel. It's not that it's bad. It's just, you know, I mean, put it this way. If you're a Van Halen fan who's nuts about David Lee Roth, they just can't let it go and accept Sammy. There's still people to this day. And, yeah. I mean, Frank and Eddie are a force of nature. But
no doubt.
Just like marriages, you know, sometimes people just they come together and then it doesn't work and they separate. I mean, my wife is not my first relationship I've ever had too. Same deal.
Dave, you take this one.
Is there a story? Yeah, please.
I don't know if there's a story as much. We just sort of, I don't know, just kind of fell out or whatever. I don't know. I don't know how to answer that without digging into it. So.
Let me take over, Dave.
Sure, Suze. Go for it. Go for it.
This will be the first time she's ever taken over, right?
No, never. I think what happens in those situations, don't forget also that after the second record, our label fell apart, basically. The label that we were signed to lost its distribution and we couldn't record. We couldn't be, they wouldn't release us from the label, then we couldn't record either. So everybody took a hiatus. I got married, I had kids, and moved to America. And so there was this kind of, just geographically, there was this distance. And it kind of went on and on. Dave played on my solo record that he came out to the US and lived there for a while. And, you know, we worked together. And then we did a little acoustic record for Liberation, which was years later. And Dave and
it was 2008, wasn't it?
Yeah, probably with Justin Stanley. And Dave and I worked on that. And then we had this idea: let's start working again and properly, you know, and let's do it with the original lineup. And we'll all get together. And I got the guys came over to LA and we worked and everything. And it became pretty obvious early on that there was some things that hadn't grown. You know, I think the growth part of a band is really important. If you find that there's people that are at a different stage of and wanting different things too, you know, I mean, your time is limited at that point too. You've got families, everyone's busy, you know, and so you kind of have to make these choices about how you want to spend your time really at the end of the day. Do you want to spend it, you know, in a debate about whatever it is, or do you want to spend it having a laugh and enjoying playing music and making music together? That's kind of the basic, you know, that's the situation that it became this sort of choice from both sides, I think, you know. Eddie and Frank are like probably, I would say, you know, my all-time favorite rhythm section. I think they're incredible. They're just amazing together as well, because they played together for so long. So there's you know, no one would ever take that away. But I have to say, you know, we work really well together with this new lineup. Dario's incredible. And Mick is incredible also. And, you know, we just have such a – it's an easy, enjoyable, great time. And we don't waste time feeling awkward about, you know, past shit or whatever it is. We have this really great – combination of people. It is going to sound different because there's different people in it, but that's fine for me. I want it to sound different. I mean, it you know, I think you'd be crazy to expect it to be the same. Even when we play the old stuff, you know, and you know, we've got two new players in. It is slightly different, but it's slightly exciting too.
Yeah. Well, of course. I mean, last thing an artist wants to do is just repeat themselves because it gets boring for them. It's kind of a weird one, I know, because being a musician as well. For a fan, it's like you want what you heard when you grew up, you know. Like the last thing you want to do is go to a Led Zeppelin concert and all of a sudden there's someone else in the band.
Well, that's why they didn't play when you know, Bonham died.
Yeah,
I mean, that's right. Why they wouldn't do it. Even when they had that, they did that reunited for that one-off show and Jason played drums. Yep. It sounded a little similar, but it was still different, you know. And oh, it's
completely.
And that's their choice. I mean, they were a lot more of a well-known band than we are. And, you know, I think it's a respect thing and, you know, you can't live your life thinking about, you know, you just got to move on with your life. And that's what we did.
Well, I look forward to the new stuff. What were you going to say, Dave? Sorry, I accidentally cut you off then, mate.
Oh, I forgot. Don't worry about it.
Okay. So I want to get into the Van Halen tour. So I've watched the documentary twice. The documentary that you guys put out for 2017, I believe, was done by Channel 9, and it's actually on Eddie's personal YouTube page, which I was really stoked that he put it up because it's very hard to see Channel 9 when you live in Tokyo. But so I watched it on there probably about a year or two ago, and then preparing for this, I was like, oh, I want to watch that again because I absolutely loved that documentary.
It's good.
The production was great. The stories were great. You guys were all open to talk about stuff. But I'd like to just expand on a little bit because just to set it up for the people who haven't seen the documentary, what a feeling that must have been. You are touring Australia. You get told – actually, you know what? I'm going to let Dave tell the story about how it came about because I think it's better coming from you guys than me. Can you tell the folks how this happened, that you first found out about going to America to do the tour?
Well, I think the background was, to my knowledge, we had Painless had been getting a pretty good run, rotation on MTV, and Valerie Bertinelli had seen it and bought the record or something. Is that right, Suze?
And then I think she heard it. I heard it on MTV and told Eddie, listen to this band.
Yeah, and then that's kind of how we got it, which was pretty cool. And then, yeah, the day that we found out, it was it still is a dream come true. Yeah.
It was for the boys.
Oh, so you didn't enjoy that?
It was for me. Suze.
It was no, for me. I loved it, but I wasn't like I knew who they were and I'd listened to them, but they weren't my life. Those guys were like wetting themselves because of Eddie. It was like, yeah. And I didn't really get that. I got who he was and I got how amazing he was and everything, but it wasn't like I didn't sort of grow up listening to them as much as sort of like a Zeppelin or, like Paul Rogers, Free and
Nice Choice,
all that kind of stuff. So for them it was, and I was really excited too, obviously, but it was for those guys, it was like another level. They were like, yeah.
They were like, bouncing off the walls, were they?
They were.
So to give you a quick little bit of background about why this is something that I personally have a little bit of investedness, and most of my audience know this, but I don't think you would know this yet, Suze, and Dave knows this too. God, come on. I'm trying to manipulate my computer here to show you this, but I keep clicking the wrong thing. I'm a bit exhausted. Did you see that Queen video that I put out? It exhausted me, and I ran myself ragged. And
I haven't seen it yet, but I will have a look after this.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. This here, which I'm going to manipulate this screen here, is a very insane moment in my life. I got to go to 5150 and hang out with Eddie for an afternoon.
Oh, how great.
Oh, wow.
So, we talked about you guys.
Did you?
Yeah. Myself out of there. So, brought it up with him. Look, I mean, I told you, I'm a huge fan of Baby Animals. I've known Dave for quite a while now, but I still am a fan of the band because I just love that music. I mean, you can tell when I play the tracks, it's a visceral thing inside me that it just gives me that, you know?
And it still sounds so timeless as well, which is
exactly
beautiful. It hasn't aged a bit, like both of you. Well, you know, I mean, Suze, Dave.
Dave, could you please remove your lips from Susie's ass?
No.
That Dave.
I had to do that. Yeah, well, yeah, that one, because this one's been putting up with you for too many years.
can we talk about Eddie again now? Like, yeah, 5150. And yep. Eddie was one of the guys that in our career that said a couple of classic things about the band.
And that's where I want to get into.
He said he to us at opportune moments. It was pretty funny.
Well, let's hear him. I mean, that's what we're here for. I want to get some of the stories.
Well, we had good fun. We were really well looked after on that run. They kind of took us under their wings. We got sound checks most of the nights, you know, whenever it was available. But they'd spend a lot of time hanging out. They'd fly in from, I think they might have been staying at Chicago or something when we were doing the Midwest. And so they'd fly in every afternoon, and you could hear once the band was in, because we'd be traveling in a bus overnight. So once they got there, you could hear Ed would do this lick, and it's like, the boys are here, right? The band's here. And
yeah.
Not long after their sound check, they'd come looking for us, because we'd be in a room down the back, you know, down the end of the hall with a couple of little amps and a couple of, you know, buttons full of beer.
There was always a lot of jamming, and Eddie was always up for a jam.
Amazing.
We'd have to leave him there in our room sometimes, go, look, we're going to go and play, but you just make yourself at home.
What a surreal experience that would be.
Yeah. Wonderful. He's such a sweet, he's such a sweet, gorgeous guy, and just a shit stirrer.
I spent about 3 hours with him on that day that I went up there, and it was kind of funny because I was working for a music store here in Japan, and we were the exclusive retailer for his EVH brand, and that's kind of how it all happened. Matt Bruck had actually called the store. You guys know who Matt is.
Yeah,
Matt called the store just by chance to buy a guitar, and we got into conversation, and he was
Maddie
asking me about
Maddie Guitar Tech, Maddie.
Yeah, but he's actually now Eddie's personal assistant.
He still is?
Right, okay.
Yeah, yeah, he still works with Ed.
Wow, that's awesome.
After all these years, like I would probably, I can't speak out of school and speak for them, but as far as I'm aware of the relationship, the person who is the absolute closest to Ed is, outside of his wife, would probably be Matt.
Matt's gorgeous.
Yeah.
We love Matt.
He's a wonderful dude. I saw him again in January at NAMM just quickly. I just happened to see him.
He's still got the hair?
Yep, still got the hair. He won't let me post. I've got some extra off-cut stuff that I've never posted online because, you know, he's like, don't do it. And actually, I must say, he gave me a wonderful compliment. He said, out of all the people we've ever brought up to 5150, you are the only dude ever outside of big networks or whatever who's never posted anything that we asked you not to post. And
yeah, cool. And
I was grateful for that, you know, the fact that he recognized that, and he said it was really sweet of him to do that.
Yeah, that's good.
You know. So it was very, very nice of him. He humbled me a lot with saying that. But
he's a sweetheart.
Yeah, he is. So after we finished doing our thing, Eddie actually said to me, look, I got something in the studio. I want you to come in and I want to show it to you. I was like, okay, this will be good. I go in there, and I don't know if you're familiar. He's built this new, like, because you know he's an engineer. He's built this new bridge that goes on his guitar, which he calls a D2H, which stands for down to hell. And he can just flip this latch and he completely retunes the guitar and it balances everything. And he can drop from like a regular E down to an A on a flip, like down to an A. That's
what I need, Dave.
And so he was standing there, and for 20 minutes, I shit you not, he had his full live rig. So 3 cabinets, 2 refrigerator rack size of gear. For 20 minutes, he just stood there and jammed for me.
Did you come out of there alive? I mean, how was your heart after that? You must have been.
The truth is, I have never had to concentrate so hard on my knees not giving out on me while I was standing up. It was earth shattering of a moment. So I kind of get how you guys would have felt.
I got the knees rattle when I met Jimmy Page backstage at an awards show, and I got the weak knees a little bit then meeting him. But you know, we toured with Robert Plant, and I thought I would get weak knees with him, even though. Yeah, I mean, there was definitely weak knee moments, but meeting Jimmy Page was that real, I couldn't breathe. that was amazing.
That's pretty awesome. And what about you when you very first met Eddie, Dave? Like, can you describe that moment, or you don't remember it? It's just a blur.
I remember the first time I clapped eyes on him. We were, it was the first night. It was Little Rock, Arkansas, I'm pretty sure. Think so. Anyway, yeah, we were sound checking early morning.
And
we were on stage, and I looked down, and Eddie and Alex are sitting in the front row, just standing there. And I'm like, I lost my shit at that point. I think I just forgot what I was playing. I went around and fiddled with my amp. I'm like, oh, God.
Something doesn't sound quite Eddie Van Halen.
But then they just came up and said g'day afterwards. And I remember that day, remember we were pulled into the parking lot, Suze, on our bus.
Yeah.
And Zeke jumped on like straight away and just started trying to intimidate us straight away. You know?
Oh, yeah.
Zeke was Sammy's tech. And, trouble. Yeah, trouble.
There was a lot of them. It was a long tour, too. I mean, we were 6 months of it was a long tour, and so we all, it was a big run, and a lot of memorable moments.
Some we can't repeat. Yeah, of course not. I know. That's the way it is in rock and roll. You know, once you're on the inside and you've got those secrets, if you start letting them out, you get pushed on the outside real fast.
But that was the day. I think it was 26th of January. I'm pretty sure.
See? Australia Day. How do you do that?
What's Australia Day?
It was Australia Day, and we had a party because I think the record had just gone number one that day, the first album at home, and we had a party in our dressing room, and the Van Halen guys came, and I did the Dance of Love on the table and pulled the.
Was that the first show?
Pulled ceiling down. I'm pretty sure.
I think we nearly got kicked off on our first show because
we did. Yeah, nearly
ceiling down, doing the Dance of Love because
I lost my footing and. Grabbed this false kind of office type ceiling, this suspended ceiling, and pulled it down, and the lights went out. There's dust, sparks, people fucking screaming and running for the exits. I remember just Woody saying, hey, because we were counting on trying to, we were thinking they might offer us that second leg that we ended up doing. And Woody said, we haven't got the second leg yet, so don't fuck this up for us, you know?
Our manager, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it is pretty incredible what happened with that first album because, I mean, if I just take the reference information from Wikipedia so it's hopefully correct, I mean, this is pretty huge. So the debut album debuted at number 6 on the ARIA chart, which for those of you who are not Australian, that's our version of the Billboard. It's our national chart. It spent 6 weeks at number 1 and eventually gained 8 times platinum, becoming the highest-selling debut Australian rock album of all time. I mean, when you go on the backs of Cold Chisel, Midnight Oil, In Excess, and so on, this is the biggest selling debut album of all time. It did get bumped 12 years later by Jet, but 12 years, you got to hold that position. Freaking unbelievable. Well done, guys. You know, that is a huge testament to all those years of everything you've done before, which I'm going to ask about in a second. For that debut album to do that and go on that far, and it even says here, Baby Animals was listed in the book as one of the top 100 best Australian albums, which is no surprise because it is just a monumental record.
Thanks, man.
That's fantastic info. So let's go back into the history a little bit. I mean, for those who haven't seen the documentary, check it out. Just go onto YouTube, look up Baby Animals documentary 2017. You'll be able to watch it. There's a lot of good stuff in there. So let's talk about your move to London, Suze, and that blonde hair.
Oh, yeah. I love talking about that. I love the 80s.
What was the motivation behind going the pop thing? Because Baby Animals being such a rock band, was that someone pushed you in that direction or you thought it was the thing at the time or what?
The short story was I got offered a record because I was in a band in Perth. I started when I was 17 and joined a local band, original band, and was with that band for 2 years. And then I ended up meeting these guys, Kevin Peake and Trevor Spencer, who'd previously been in England for 20 years and worked with all these amazing artists there. And they'd started a small label back in Perth. And I started working with them, and through them I was offered a deal from EMI in the UK. And basically this was in like 1985, and I was like, who would say no? I was like, sure, let's go. And I went and moved to London and sort of kind of didn't know anybody and ended up working with a great manager there, Peter Lister Todd, who I'm still very close with these days. We always catch up. But he, so I had this deal with EMI, and they didn't really know much about me other than I sent them a bunch of demos and I'd done some little videos, and they wanted to push me down that pop road. And, you know, I balked at it for a long time. I did a few singles. I wrote with people. Basically, I partied for 4 years, let's be honest. There wasn't an awful lot of playing going on, or work. There was other kind of playing, but work, there wasn't a lot. It was, you know, they put me together with writers that were very pop. And then it was the final straw, really, when they suggested I do something with Stock Aitken Waterman. They're great. It was perfect for Kylie and all these artists. Fantastic. I love all that stuff, by the way. It's not like a sledge. It just wasn't my style, wasn't my thing. And that's when
so
I met
were
John.
You burning to be a rocker on the inside the whole time?
I was always a rocker. I was always a guitar head. I grew up with that stuff. I grew up with my brother's record collection, heavy English guitar-based rock. It was my love. I still love it. And so when I met Woodruff, John Woodruff in London, it was the time to make a move, and it was, you know, the best thing was to come back to Australia and just put a band together, and that's how it happened. It was with the help of Woodruff giving me, you know, got me a little small $10,000 publishing deal so that I could come back, paid for a little bit of, you know, flying back, get in a house, I had a shoebox.
10 grand back then is a lot of money.
Yeah, it was an advance, it was a short-term advance. I had to pay back pretty quick.
Yeah.
So, you know, and then once I got back to Australia, it was pretty much just kind of boots on the ground and find people. And, you know, I knew Frank because I played in a band with Frank before. You know, it was one of those things. It was Frank called Eddie, and then we were all in Sydney and audition, and Dave came in, and it was just Dave's great. And then we just, once the unit was together, it was just every day. Like, we just all wanted to work every day. We were very excited. Also, because John Woodruff was involved, you know, we knew that it wasn't going to be wasted time. Mm. It was going to be, we were going to have that sort of help to get stuff moving overseas, which is what we all wanted. And, but London was just an amazing time. It was such fun. And, you know, it was EMI, so I was with all these amazing bands. It was like, you know, Queen were on EMI. There was, you know, Duran Duran, it was Sade, it was, you know, all these amazing artists. And in those days, they'd throw money at, you know, like, take this, take that, go here, go there. You know, it was mental.
A bit different than today. And then, Dave, your entry into the fold, I believe you came from a Cold Chisel tribute band.
Yeah, I played in this band called Swing Shift from about 86 onwards. Myself and the singer Andy had an original band, but we were coming into summer and we didn't have any work and we were both depressed. So what are we going to do? Well, it's time to kill the sacred cow. And we formed the Chisel Tribute Act. And got work, got a shit ton of work. Excuse me.
You guys were big.
Coronavirus. Hey?
You guys were big.
I remember hearing about Swing Shift in Adelaide. So, yeah, you guys were big.
Yeah, we used to play in Adelaide a bit. We used to come down and play Melbourne, and we had our own road crew. We used to fly, all that sort of stuff. But it was a means to an end, right? We were all making a wage and all that sort of thing. And I was going for auditions. And he just playing with other bands and just seeing, because I was, what do you call it, industry aware. And I went for an audition with Rose Tattoo for they just released the Beats of a Single Drum record, the one with Suddenly on it. And they were about to go on tour.
I remember that song well. I can still play it on the piano, funny enough, all these years later. I remember that song well.
It wasn't the ones I had to practice for the audition, though, I must say. But I thought, well, it's worth a go. It's just worth the go to go and have a hack, go and have a play. I knew I wasn't going to go and get the gig, though, because I had a blonde mullet and no tattoos. So I didn't really
Who was the other guitar player in the band at the time that you went for your audition?
Tim Gaze was playing in the band at the time. It was okay. It was Tim Gaze, Andy Sishon, Scotty Johnson.
Andy Sishon.
And Anger. Yeah. And so Andy Sishon's playing bass. So I became friends with Andy. I went back for a second audition thinking, oh, I might have this in the bag, you know. This is just crazy enough to work. However, didn't get the gig, but made friends with Andy Sishon, who at the time was engaged to a lady called Adrian Driscoll, who was John Woodruff's PA. And so when Suze came out and hooked up with Woody and they were looking for players, Andy suggested to Adrian to give me a hack. And that's how I...
Andy Sishon's fault.
Yeah, it's all his fault. Yeah.
I love how we just got an exclusive. All these years later, Suze didn't even know the connection of how this all happened.
I think I remember you saying that, telling me that once before, but I don't have Dave's memory. He's got a good memory.
Oh, don't destroy me. I wanted to make that an exclusive. Suze, come on. I wanted to feel special. Well,
just going to that audition, I knew that I wasn't going to, I knew that I probably wasn't going to get the gig, you know, but I thought you've got to be out there, you know, got to be in it to win it, sort of thing. So,
of course you do. Of course you do. So the band gets together, you record the album. I mean, I've seen on the documentary, for people who want to catch this background, Dave had the absolute shit beaten out of him by Mike Chapman, their producer. How ready were you to kill him during those recording sessions?
You play better when you're angry, but then we'd go out later to JD Gates and get on it and all that sort of stuff. There was no kind of malice or anything like that there. That's just the way he kind of did things.
The way he operated.
You know, that's the way he operated. You play better when you're mad.
He did it to me as well a few times, you know, just not all the time, but sometimes he was, you know, Dave, you know, there was a lot of times where he wouldn't do that. Like he'd just let you go. Yeah. But there were certain times when he'd be in the mood to have freaking go at you. And because we were so green and at that point, we were like, Mike Chapman says that's what we have to do, then we do it.
That's what we have to do.
Because
I used to get paranoid about, you know, my playing and everything like that. And he'd say, I said, does it sound all right? And he goes, well, it sounds like you.
As opposed to, yeah, no, that sounded okay. It sounds like you.
I grabbed the guitar because I want to ask a question about the parts and stuff. So if we get into, like, say you've got your intro for early, yeah, but I want to ask a question. I'm all set up. I got a camera on my keyboard and everything. That's what I do. So, like, for example, with your intro, the early warning, right? Is this right or is this wrong? Sorry, I'm bending the string a bit. I've got a locking trem. But is that right or wrong as far as...
Hang on, let me just...
I'd love to get some parts on this sort of stuff. It's one of the exclusive things we could do on this show that most shows don't do.
Can I go take a wee break while you guys are doing that?
Sure. Dave, is that the... Oh, he's got his headphones off.
This is the boring shit now.
Is that the guitar that Eddie gave you?
This is the one.
Oh, dude. Hang on, I got to solo this. So this is the guitar, folks. I want to see this. I want to see how you play this quickly.
It was close. I've tuned A440 though. So
I'll grab an E guitar. That's fine.
But it's got that. Oh, yuck! So you do that bend. The 9 to 11 on the G. But you got your little pinky on 10. Which actually Suze came up with that line. She's just like when we were jamming at my nan's spare room.
That's cool.
And it's another cup.
Very country kind of lick.
It's a bit country.
So is this correct for the next line? I'm curious about this one too.
Yeah, it's pretty close. It's from that E.
You play it down there.
I only pulled this girl out this morning, so she hasn't been played for a while. So she's.
I appreciate you pulling it out for us, man. I really do.
Yeah, jeepers. Yeah. That's that E.
That is so cool.
That's my little, it's almost a Van Halen-y tribute, funnily enough.
And it was before you even got on the tour.
Yeah.
That is so cool.
That's the girl, she's what, strung with nines or something to A440. Yeah, it needs a refret. It needs a bit of work. It's just been
so
kind of.
Tell us the story about like Ed giving you that guitar and the moment when that happened. Like, it's pretty special that Eddie Van Halen gives you a guitar.
Kind of cool, actually, yeah.
Kind of cool. You never gave me a bloody guitar.
Well, it was extremely cool. It was the last night of the first leg. So we managed to secure the second leg. And the next day, I think we had a week off or something. And then we were going to go to, we did a bunch of club shows in Europe for a month or so during that break and then resume on the second leg. But it was the last night of the first leg. And Ed would be, yeah, as we were saying before, he'd be always in our room. He's always have a guitar. Guy's always wearing a guitar, just plays all the time.
Which just is, loves,
you
know, it.
I guess that's how you get so good. Came in with a case, plonked this case down on the desk, opened it up. He goes, "Hey, come check this out." And I'm like, "Oh, yeah. So is that your new guitar?" And he goes, "No, it's your new guitar."
Wow.
Yeah. That's great. Yeah. I played the shit out of it for the next couple of years, you know, played it all day, every day kind of thing. That's why there's no frets on it at the moment.
That's insane, man. What a cool thing to have happen in your life.
Yeah,
to get Eddie Van Halen to give you a guitar. So that's a Music Man, is it, that one?
It's the Music Man EVH, yeah, Ernie Ball. Yeah.
Yep. That's awesome. Wow. That's a special, special guitar right there. Do you still, like, drag her out? When was the last time you took her out on stage, do you reckon?
It was quite a while ago because, I mean, you know, as I said, I did play it a lot the following few years. So it need all the frets are all flat. There's no – all the intonation's a bit out because the frets have just been – and I just haven't – I don't know. I just haven't got around to just getting them replaced.
You should take it to Simon Cotter. He's actually in – I saw him in the chat before. He's here as Educated Tone. You know Simon, right?
I know Simon well, yeah. Yeah,
he's a very, very dear friend of mine. You should take it to Simon. He does great work. So, Suze, what about you as a guitar player? I think this is something that doesn't get talked enough about. Like Dave just told us, which I wasn't aware of, that opening lick for Early Warning you wrote, which is so cool.
I sang it, you know.
Yeah, it was ow.
I'm good with melodies, but I'm not as good as Dave at translating them. I play. He's a genius. He's amazing. And so I let him do what he's great at. And I'm a backup. You know, I'm really, you know, I'm just guitar wise. I do what I need to do. And you know, I'm not in that league. So I like the idea. Also, when we're performing, it's about. What's right for the song, and also just being able to enjoy that being a vocalist and sort of, I don't want to have to play a lot. I end up playing a lot most nights, but generally I love it when I get a break and I don't have to play because I can just enjoy just singing. But, you know, I'm not a guitar head. I'm really not. Dave knows. How does this work, Dave?
Because I like when I've seen you guys play live a couple of times over the years, and you've done One Too Many, which I love that tune, but you don't normally do the ending with the double kicks and all that stuff on it, you know, because you've got like the funky guitar. Oh, am I getting it right? It's One Too Many, right? It's not.
Yeah, it's One Too Many.
Yeah, it is One Too Many. Yeah, yeah. Little. Can you play that riff for us? Do you remember off the top of your head? Because I want.
bit. Yeah.
That's what I was going to ask. So that's how you do it live.
Yeah.
So
we haven't played that ending like that for a while.
Because even when you did the reunion, you didn't do that with Frank and Eddie, did you? With the ending?
We did it.
No, I don't think we did it.
I can tell you right now, as a fan, I love that ending so much. It's just it just goes, and it's just gorgeous. I love that ending.
Maybe we should do it again. Yeah, we haven't done that for ages. Please. I forgot about that.
Wow. I'm glad I could remind you, because I'm sure there's plenty of fans sitting out there going, yes, they're going to do that again, because it's so powerful and gutsy and gorgeous.
Yeah.
I'd like to now move on to I want to go back to Shaved and Dangerous shortly. But I want to move on because I've got a song queued up here to This Is Not the End. Sorry, is that right? This Is Not the End. That's right. That's the album. You have some beautiful lyrics and melodies and things on that record. Like when I first started listening to it, the thing we were talking about before about Frank and Eddie not being there and the difference in sound, like Frank's snare drum is like Kenny Aronoff's. It just goes, I'm fucking here. And bang, and it's insane. You got a very different sound on that record. But once I started breathing in the record more and allowing myself to do the hardest thing that a fan can do, which is let go of what made me fall in love with the band and find my new discovery with the band, I went, wow, this album's got some truly beautiful magic on it. A chorus in particular that I really love. I think lyrically, I think melody-wise, I think arrangement and structure and everything would be Warm Bodies. It's just a beautiful, beautiful song. So for those of you out there who haven't heard it, have a listen to this.
My body's your friend.
What a vocal performance. Like, that is just stunning. Arrangements are beautiful. If I'm not mistaken, there's a bit of like B3 Hammond type organ in the background there.
Yeah, there's a couple of little organy colors and stuff in
there.
Yeah.
Like, what a gorgeous song. And a very uplifting lyric too, you know, like really blown away by that. I think fans who have let it go by the wayside need to get that album and give it a go because it's a beautiful record.
You embrace the country in that one too a lot more than...
I'm a bit of a country girl at heart. You know, I do love a country melody and I love a country lyric, you know.
Yep.
And
it works. And then you've tweaked it just enough. That's beautiful. Yeah,
I love that song. We play that every now and again. We pull that out. But I mean, you know, we are a heavy rock band, but we're big on our ballady sort of softer songs. I think when we do a song like that, we really commit to it sounding how it should sound for the song. And you know, there's no middle ground, but it's either light, it's light, a lot of light and dark. You know, there's not much sort of in between with us, I think. Maybe
that's it. You've defined it and you're happy with it, and that's great. And then, you know,
we're not afraid of exploring the depth of stuff. No. You know,
we're trying to learn to just let the song write, Dave. We're always saying, let's just let the song dictate it and don't worry about any preconceived ideas, or just make it work for the song.
It'll tell us what it wants, and it, you know, it's pretty obvious when it doesn't want something.
Yeah.
So going back to NAMM this year, I sent Dave a video because I was at the NAMM booth and I was hanging out with the guys from Cole Clark Guitars, Miles Jackson, the CEO, and they released a new guitar, which leads me on to what I think is probably my favorite Baby Animals song. It's kind of hard to pick a favorite per se, but if I had to sort of go, yep, this is the one that it just... I put on probably more than any other, although the following track after it as well does it for me too. And this one involves Suze's ex-husband, Nuno Bettencourt. This song, it just does it for me because I can. Track number 9, I think it is, off of Shaved and Dangerous. That song is just unbelievably good. Everything about that song is perfection. The Zeppelin homage in the middle, Nuno's playing on the acoustic, the way that Dave does what Dave does, the fills, the bass lines, the harmonies and the vocals, just everything about that song to me is blatant perfection. So when I went to NAMM, I shot this little video here that I sent over to Dave, which he got a good laugh out of, and he sent me back a great message. So here's a quick shot of that video. Dave Leslie, Baby Animals. Hey, it's diverting through to my Bluetooth. Give me one quick second here, sorry. Technical thing. Bloody Bluetooth. Okay, here we go. I've got that fixed now. All right, so let's get that playing again. Got the sound working right. Here we go. Oh, come on. Those technical glitches. Now it won't even play. So this is going so well,
prepared.
Isn't it?
So prepared.
Yeah, I thought it was going to work and it was going to be smooth and it was going to be cool. And, of course, this is the joy of going live, folks. This should work now. And if it doesn't work, I'm just going to abandon the idea.
Try it.
Damn it. Doesn't want to work. Anyway, so the point is I recorded this little thing and I actually played Because I Can for Dave. And Dave actually sent me back this message and he goes, mate, that was brilliant. You play it better than I do. So, I mean, I adore that song. So can we explore, was it Nuno who wrote the riff that bought on the song, or did you have the melody, or did, like, how did that particular song come together, if you guys can remember?
That's for my solo record, right?
Because Shaved and Dangerous.
Oh, Shaved and Dangerous.
Hang on, here we go. Here it is here as a quick reminder.
Crazy old world lately. Lose a little sun underneath.
So, I mean, his tone and his playing and his flicks like that and the way he does it. Do we recall how that came together, or am I asking an absurd question that's just going to go nowhere?
Because I Can, was that me and Nuno write that?
Yeah.
I think it was you and Nuno, yeah.
I probably, a lot of that stuff, I would have had the melody and the lyrics and stuff like that, and Nuno would have added that guitar part for sure. Yeah. Can't really remember. I mean, there would have been a lot of, and that was 1990. We weren't married then, were we?
No, I don't think so.
92?
93 when it was released.
Yeah. Yeah. He would have done that. And I can't even remember that one. But Dave?
A long time ago, huh?
Was I? What happened?
Yeah, I think because I think you had the messing with it. That little figure, but then Nuno's all about that.
Oh, yeah.
All that sort of flat five.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Discord and stuff.
Were we in Florida or something? We did some stuff. He was working in a studio there, and I think we might have. Like, weren't we in Florida recording?
Because I Can was Bahamas, but we did some demos in Florida after that.
Oh, right, yeah. And then Bob St. John engineered. Nuno did. He did because he'd be my friend, and he did Because I Can and
Life from a Distance.
Life from a Distance. Yeah, I remember. He sang harmonies on Life from a Distance, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, probably. Yeah.
So here's the Zeppelin-y type thing with the flat fives Dave was talking about. Such a great feel. And the turnaround's amazing. And the drum fill.
Yeah.
that just inside of me personally just opens up all these like emotions and feelings and adrenalines and just goes, yes. And maybe it is because I'm a musician, but I just can't help but think, you know, if this song was released as the single back then, especially on the back of Wholehearted and everything going on with Dream, I think that song probably would have done what, say, a song like At the End of the Day wasn't able to do for the band. I think that song probably scared fans too much. But I think this song,
there was a lot of stuff in that record that was, you know, not necessarily radio friendly stuff, I think. And I think maybe when we're thinking of singles, there was the idea was to not complicate it too much and put out.
Maybe she didn't have her phone on charge. Oh, sorry, her computer, phone, whatever she was using. Maybe she ran out of battery.
Yeah, right. But that, it's funny because there's a lot of Nuno in that thing. But that's good fun that, you know, have him in the studio, though. I mean, the guy's got a hell of a work ethic. So it was really great to just be influenced by that and, you know, be around that.
Talent and a half. Like,
and he gave me an N4 as well. So I got another guitar from another hero.
Wow. That must be kind of weird, though, like when you've got a guitar hero who ends up marrying the singer in your band. That's got to be a bit of a strange thing. It's kind of like marrying your sister, isn't it?
Well, we didn't lose a singer. We just gained another guitar player.
Yeah. Well, she's back. Here we go.
Sorry. I don't know what happened there. It just went
I thought maybe you didn't have your computer on battery or something. The battery just ran out.
No, it just shut down. We're back now.
I was just saying to Dave, it must be
talking rubbish anyway.
Yeah, well, what I said today was it must be weird when one of your guitar heroes marries your singer. It's kind of like a dude marrying your sister kind of a deal. You know, I got to be careful what I say about Nuno because he knows me, and if I say the wrong thing, I guarantee you he's going to come up to me and go, "I saw your interview, Jason. I'm going to kick your fucking ass right now." It's just the way. Actually, he wouldn't even warn me; he'd just do it.
No, we're all cool. Everyone's good. We're all fine.
And you guys have two kids together, is that right?
We do. Yeah, my kids are both with him at the moment in quarantine. My son is there. Has been staying with him doing high school there for a while, and my daughter was visiting and then got kind of locked down. They're all there, which is good that they're both together and they're all hanging and, you know, spending some time, which is good. But I just, you know, we just have to video chat and all that stuff. Yeah.
It's good. We got these technologies. I mean, we can do this show, you know, the whole point of this show is to try and give people who are stuck in quarantine to have a chance to hear from their heroes and enjoy, you know, what's going on, update where the bands are at and all that sort of thing. That's the whole point of this show. Positivity.
Yes. And it's been actually a lifesaver having, you know, hanging with the band Zoom and all that stuff. You know, keeping busy and connecting that way.
Otherwise, you sit in your little shell and you disappear.
Just a quick bit of housekeeping.
What's that, Dave?
We'll have to do another Zoom next week.
No, well, let's not leave it that long. I reckon I'm doing one today with my family. I'm going to do one with the Jen and Dan and everyone, and we should do another one with the band. Later or tomorrow.
Okay.
Let's do it right now. Good. Yay. On my show. Woohoo.
Not the same.
I just got to do a quick bit of housekeeping. I just got a text message from Felix right now, who was supposed to be on the show this coming Saturday night for the Americans and Sunday for our side of the world of Australia and Japan and stuff. He's had an unfortunate double booking come up, and I know what the other job is, and he can't move that one, so the Phil X show will be getting shifted to a little bit later in next week, just so that you know. Are you guys familiar with Phil X?
Yes.
Yeah. He's the guitar player who took over from Richie Sambora in Bon Jovi,
right?
And he is a monster musician. Like, this
what happened with Richie Sambora? I mean, I don't even know what happened there.
Look, I don't want to speak out of school, but it's kind of public information. Richie has a bit of a issue, this is the story I hear. I've never heard it from him personally. I don't know Richie. I know Phil really well, but I don't know Richie.
Allergies.
Yeah, allergies.
Nose beers.
The same. the same allergies. That's what I've heard. And he just decided not. This is the truth of it, and everybody knows this. He just decided not to rock up to a show one night. True story.
That's always a good grounds for divorce, isn't it?
Wow, yeah. Pretty much, yeah.
So, here we go. Look, I like this comment. This was from when we had Because I Can on just before, and that's why Shaved, in my opinion, is pure brilliance. The best Baby Animals album.
Jason Hill.
So
we paid him to say that.
Yeah.
Sorry, Suze, what was that?
Can people comment live? Is that how this works?
That's exactly how it works. So people can comment.
How many people are watching this?
We currently have 205 people watching right now. We have 205 people. So that's between Facebook and YouTube. We stream simultaneously.
So can people ask questions? And let's see if anyone wants to ask anything.
Well, I'll tell you what, let's go one further than that. If anybody watching wants to jump in on the stream here, as long as you're polite and respectful, I have the ability to kick you the hell out of this chat.
As long as you have your clothes on.
Yeah, well,
that's also yeah, that's
mandatory.
Yeah.
So okay. I'm going to be really, really kind here. Now, I will say, I have to get this bit of housekeeping out of the way on every show. I can't monetize these videos because I go to the extent of putting up the songs, we play the music, we listen to the music, we talk about the music. The record companies instantly take all the revenue away from me being able to monetize. I do have a PayPal link in the description. We don't try and force people to do it. We don't beg for Patreons. We don't do any of that shit. If people feel generous and they want to donate to the show, because we put a lot of work into preparing all this stuff, we'd be grateful. If you don't want to, it's cool. It's fine. It's just I've got to get it out there.
Yeah,
so
cool.
I've just hit publicly. Here is the link on YouTube and Facebook. And if somebody puts that in, please use Google Chrome. If you can, it will work from a phone. Two important parts of this. So here we go. One, try to wear headphones if you can, something with a mic attached. Two, make sure that if you're at home on your computer that you turn the sound off on YouTube or Facebook or wherever you're watching first, because it's going to interrupt the entire stream. So, you know, it's really cool. We've got a few people here who are quite excited. Can you guys not see the chats on the side of your screen there?
Live comments. You've got to go over to live comments. Right. Oh, wow. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, there's a good question.
Wow.
This is a great question. I really like this song. Can we hear from the guys about the writing of Lights Out at 11? I believe one of you lost a friend to suicide as a true story, and that's how that song came about. Is that right?
Yes, it was. It was a friend of ours who was in a bad way, and he was a friend of mine from London, actually, and he was actually managing Susie and the Banshees for a little while, for a minute, and was accused of something that he didn't do, and he got very upset, and he was so that song is about him.
It's a beautiful lyric in that song. He can't confide in suicide, I'm blanking right in this moment, but there's beautiful lyrics in that. You really did an amazing job with that.
Thank you.
To handle such a sensitive subject like that so well.
Yeah, it's a dark subject, and, you know, we put that out as
a
single.
It's a hard one to talk about, isn't it?
Song.
It happens. Another question that I'm curious about the answer to as well, this comes from Michelle. Where did you come up with the title for Shaved and Dangerous?
Dave.
I love Dave's grin.
All right. We were recording at one point. I think we'd left Bearsville, and we were out in Compass Point in the Bahamas. And Woody, our manager, used to have this mate, Rick. He used to come out and visit him, and they used to just hang out and have a bit of fun and everything. And one day, Rick walked into the studio and said, figure you guys have been away from home for a while, so I think you might need this. And he slapped this magazine down on the mixing desk, and it was entitled Shaved.
And, okay.
I don't need to sort of go into too much detail as to what the contents were, but even that afternoon, he came in, he goes, I've got it. Shaved and Dangerous as the
Rick,
album title.
Rick Arnstein. Crazy MF.
He was off the charts, man, that guy. Yeah. Funny, very funny guy.
Irreverent. We were very irreverent when it came to the seriousness of, you know, our band and how it was perceived. And we didn't really care. It was always, we'll never let a good, you know, a joke, a good song get in the way of a good joke. You know, it was like,
yeah,
just always wanted
the Aussie mentality.
It really is.
We don't need to have some fun.
Probably to our detriment sometimes. People, I mean, we got on stage in Alabama and played Sweet Home Alabama one night, one day, and our, we came off stage and our manager was like, when are you guys going to take this seriously?
we're in Sweden. We're in Sweden with Brian Adams and we played Mamma Mia and he fucking flipped out then too. It's like I've spent all this time. I've spent months trying to take you guys seriously. And,
oh, that's so funny.
Oh, Buddy Wang's in the house.
Buddy Wang, I think it's Wang. Oh, we've got to say hi to some people. How do you do that?
Well, I'm waiting for them. Like, I've sent the link out and nobody's taken up. I mean, if for some reason the link didn't come through and I thought it did, hit me up on Facebook. Send me a message through Facebook and I'll get to you. So just look up the show's name, Live Streams with Famous Friends, and then it's got by Jason McNamara being who I am. But if you just type in live streams on Facebook, it'll come up with
Michelle
that.
Michelle Kennedy, hi, Suze. Do you still have Mum Ray Marini's painting you bought from Perth? She met you and said you were lovely. Ray Marini's painting. Don't know. Next.
Well, we have our first person to jump in. This is a good friend of mine who actually helped to introduce me to this idea of doing these live streams. But luckily for me, I got a lot of famous buddies, so I can pull this one off quite well. But this is Johnny Bean, all the way from the Bay Area.
Hey.
Hey.
Hey, Johnny Bean.
Hi. Nice to see everybody.
Hey. You're really very well equipped there.
Thank
well,
you.
He started this whole stream thing long before me. So, Johnny, did you see these guys with Van Halen on the For Unlawful Carnal Knowledge tour?
I did. I saw you guys. You guys opened up Omaha, Nebraska. I want to say it was like March of 92.
Oh, okay.
And, and I've got a really cool story that I've remembered all these years.
Thanks, Johnny. That's all the time we've got right now.
really quick. I remember Suze. I remember I was sitting in the grass outside the Omaha, I guess would have been the amphitheater or whatever it was. And I was sitting there and I remember you walked past me into the venue.
What did I do?
You walked right past me. I remember I recognized you from the music videos and I was like, oh, and then you were gone, you know?
Oh, sorry. I didn't stop.
It was cool. It was very cool.
Oh, that's good. Well, I remember opening for Van Halen it was like every night was going into battle because there was Van Halen fans are pretty die hard, hardcore. You know, we had to give it everything.
Johnny's
we had.
One of them. He knows.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know a lot of them. Yeah.
Yeah, I'll bet.
But yeah, you guys were great though. You guys were awesome.
Thank you.
Oh, thanks, man.
It's really great. Great to talk to you.
Trial by fire.
Cool. And Dave, awesome Ernie Ball guitar, man. I have one as well. I have one as well. Yeah.
Except you weren't given yours by Eddie Van Halen.
No, but yeah, mine, I played for years and years and years as well. Mine is a 92.
Oh, okay.
That wasn't that the year he brought them out, 92?
91, 92. I think
he
the amp
prototype when we were playing with him.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I was asked a question by somebody who wanted me to do this, and I'm glad I've remembered this right now. The question I was asked, Dave, was did you use 5150 amps on Shaved and Dangerous?
Yes. I think there was a 5150, a couple of Marshalls, but we had the APV endorsement during that time. So there was a couple of 5150 heads there, yeah.
And so, Suze, are you actually playing guitar on the records or is it all Dave and then you just do parts live or do you actually record on the records, on the, particularly those first two, but anything since as well?
No, I let Dave do it all because, let's be honest, there's only a certain amount of hours in the day. No, I always used to. I have played a couple of things. I played. Yeah, a couple
you played the solo in Stupid.
I did play a solo in Stupid, but also
got a solo away.
And I did play the ending of Backbone.
Oh, that is you do it, the clean part.
The picking.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. The acoustic part. I'll chuck it on right now so people know what we're talking about. I hope you don't mind me doing this with all the songs, but I like doing this because I like giving people references. So this is the part Susie's talking about. I'll just get up a little bit further.
I play as like.
That's nice. It's a good tone too. Is it a Martin?
Gosh, I don't even know what it was. It could have been anything.
The acoustic was lying around the studio.
Yeah.
Beautiful cot wire there, Dave. Such a great tone all around.
It's woman tone.
It's beautiful.
The woman tone.
The woman tone, which is not something that everybody knows about, I found out recently. Maybe the younger. Remember we were on, we're doing the shows with Living End, like, I don't know, a month ago, a couple of months ago, or however long ago it was. And I was saying to Chris Cheney, I was talking to them, you know, like that woman tone was so, and he's like, what the fuck, what is that? I was like, what do you mean? And then I went around asking everybody in the whole tour, you guys know what that is, don't you? And they were like, no.
Yeah.
The whole world knew and every guitar player knew.
So it's what, the fact that a girl's fingers just have a different tone in them? Is that what you're getting at?
Dave.
No,
it was more in the solo. It's either a cock bar or you turn your tone control between 1 and 0.
Oh, sorry, I'm with you now.
The Eric Clapton
Cream thing. That there's a cool YouTube of Cream doing interviews from about 67 where Eric sits in front of his amp and he talks about his gear. He explains what the woman tone is. It's very BBC, but it's really good.
Caleb Rappaport, I've just sent you the link to your Facebook Messenger so you can come in and ask the question about the shows yourself on the show. So come on in and say hello. He'll be a blast to have in. Johnny, I'm going to let you go just so I can make room for other people to jump in, mate. But thank you for coming to say hello.
Thank you, Johnny.
Thank you. Great to see you guys.
Thanks, Johnny.
Just quick plug before he goes, folks. Johnny Bean TV, Johnny Bean Live. He does shows every for American time, Tuesday nights, Friday nights, and a very late show on Saturday nights. And they sit around and talk about guitars, and I get on there occasionally and dribble on too. So Johnny Bean's a good dude. So there you go.
Nice to meet you, Johnny.
Thank you. All right. Bye, nice guys.
See you, man.
Bye.
Take care, buddy.
Thank
you. All right. So that was cool. So you walk past him. That's his story. That's pretty cool. And he got such a buzz out of that, which is awesome.
That's nice.
So, people, you've got an opportunity before we end the show at some stage here, because I know Suze didn't want to go for too long. She's got other stuff on today. So,
I've got another room to go into at some point today. You know,
that's what you mean by honestly, another room to go into.
I mean, I've got a date in my shower later.
Yeah, you don't want to be late to your lounge.
No.
Yeah. Now I know where you go. See, we're not on lockdown in Japan, so I didn't catch where it was going there. Mate. Yeah, we're on a strongly requested to stay home situation. So the reason is because here in Japan, it's actually in the constitution of the country that you can't do a lockdown.
Wow.
Okay.
So they're in the processes of trying to figure out how they can do something about that, because this is a very different serious situation. But legally, the country, and as we all know, a constitution goes beyond law. Mm. They can't actually enforce that.
How long have you been there?
I've been in Tokyo now for 8 years.
Wow.
I got a wife and two kids, so my wife is Japanese.
Is that why you live there?
Okay, so to fill you in, because you asked, I originally moved to Osaka in 2002, May of 2002, because I'd met a Japanese girl back home in Adelaide. And I went there to be with her, and like relationships happen, you know, we move, we take chances. It didn't work out. Met another girl, we moved back home. But instead of going to Adelaide, I was like, I've lived in Osaka for 1 year and 8 months. I can't go back to Adelaide. It's just not going to happen. So I moved to Melbourne. And Melbourne is such a great town. Dave knows, he lives there now. Melbourne's just got an energy about it, you know.
But then when did you go back to Japan?
Well, I had the Japanese girl that I had met after the first one. She moved to Australia with me. That didn't work out. And the next girl that I had come and move into my house as a housemate turned out to be the one that I'm now married to. And that was 10 years ago.
And she's Japanese.
Yeah.
And so that's why you live there.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, you know, look, the story about why we're staying here as far as in my personal heart, and I'm not trying to pluck anybody's heartstrings, it's just the reality. My father-in-law passed away from cancer 7.5 years ago, and my mother-in-law is now looking after his parents.
Uh-huh.
So, and I have a 4.5-year-old daughter, a 6.5-year-old son, and just at least in my heart, I don't want to take them away from her.
How is Japanese?
It's pretty good. I mean, if you can speak any Japanese, sure, I can do it quickly on air with you. But if you don't, I'm just going to sound like an idiot talking bullshit and no one's going to understand me. But I can survive, no problem.
Country. It is a beautiful country.
Yeah, it's a complicated country, though. But that's what you get when you live here.
Yeah, but very beautiful.
What, so you've been over here before?
My first trip I ever made overseas was to Japan. When I was with EMI, I did a little press trip to Japan, and it was the first time I'd traveled overseas. It was the first time I saw snow. It was the first time I'd been in an earthquake.
You get it all in one in Japan.
Went to Kyoto. It was amazing.
And if you're a Japanese girl, like, they wouldn't do it to you as a foreigner, but if you're a Japanese girl, it'd be the first time you get inappropriately touched on a train by a stranger groping you. It's a terrible part of the culture.
What is that?
You would have turned around and decked them.
Chicken?
Yeah, exactly. All right, now we've got another gentleman here who's going to come in and ask a question who I'm going to introduce him because he's actually going to be on our show on the 22nd for American time, 23rd for our side of the world. He plays guitar. Actually, you know what? I'm going to let him introduce his band and tell you the story. This is Caleb Rappaport, folks.
Hello.
Caleb, welcome.
Hey, Caleb.
How are you?
Hi.
Good, man.
How you doing?
All right, Caleb, tell us your story, man. Tell us what Jason didn't want to tell us.
Uh-oh.
He's frozen up.
He's frozen.
He has
He's not
frozen.
Posing.
come on, Caleb. What's going on, mate?
Caleb's story.
So Caleb plays in a very, very, very unique Van Halen tribute band.
Oh.
They are called Nerd Halen. So they dress up as nerds, and they do the whole thing. In actual fact, I've got some photos here that I was using for a presentation that I did. I'll just grab it up right now. Nerd Halen. Here we go.
Log back on, like, get out and come back in. Well, maybe
he'll figure it out. He knows what he's doing with all this stuff. He just he's not too he's gone. He'll be back. Sorry, Suze. All right, here you go. Here's Nerd Halen. This is their photo.
Wow. I love it. Nerd Halen is so good.
Yeah, and they do it really well. They do it in character. Their lead singer, who's a guy down the front with his thumb up, that's Hal Sparks, who's a comedian, and he's a very, very, very funny dude. He does the best banter on stage, and he's actually a working comedian in America, and he's a hell of a vocalist. He can nail the Dave stuff really well. There's a few clips out there where he had a bit of a scratchy voice, but he still went on.
Oh, I'm going to have to Google that, Nerd Halen.
Nerd Halen. They're fantastic. Come on, Caleb. Come on back, mate. Make this work. Here he is. He's back. Here he is. Into the stream. So, Caleb, I did tell him about Nerd Halen, and we just showed them some photos while you were gone. And
thank
Susan,
you.
Your number one fan already.
Very excited. Oh, very excited to Google you later.
I had to do my Suze impression right there with my computer dying. Boom. See ya.
Yeah, bye. I'm out.
No, because I was on my phone, but then I realized the phone wasn't going to work. And then I was like, oh, I'll get my laptop. And then I forgot to, if the laptop isn't plugged in, it dies in like 5 seconds. Yeah. So, but yeah.
Where are you, Caleb? Where are you?
I'm in Santa Monica, California.
Santa Monica.
Yes.
Oh.
Yeah.
My son used to call it Santa Monica.
Santa Monica.
Well, Santa Monica?
What's that?
My son used to call Santa Monica Santa Monica.
Yeah.
He couldn't say it properly.
Well, it's funny. When I moved to Southern California, I was 8, and I saw Santa in front of everything, and I thought, Santa? Santa Claus? Like, you know.
And then Monica. I'm living in
Santa Monica.
Santa's everywhere. Santa Anna, Santa Monica.
That's good. Yeah. I like that one.
Yeah.
How you doing, man?
I'm good. This is it's really nice to talk to you, and Jason's doing great things with this. So
yeah,
it's awesome.
Thank you.
No, my question was, I'm such a Van Halen head that all things, and by the way, that story with him saying, "No, it's your guitar." I mean, I kind of wanted to ask you just like what was your reaction, and how long did you actually process that? You know,
My reaction was disbelief at the time. I had one of those weak knee kind of moments. And I'm still processing it. It's good.
I bet, I right?
28 years
of,
later.
Kind of sharing the story, you know? Yeah. Like, you know, I played the guitar to hell. Like, there's no frets left on it, man. There's no.
Did you ever think about, like, I can't play this? Or no?
I wanted to find out what the secret was, because we were using 5150s at the time, and I had a Les Paul Custom. Mm-hmm. I thought, maybe if I have the guitar and I got the amps, I can somehow find out what the secret is. But it just sounded like me.
It's in there. It's right here. That's where this
tell
is.
Tell us the story about. Yeah. Well, you know, there's a good segue here about the, you know, playing through Eddie's rig.
Mm.
Sounded like that. Doesn't matter.
I worked on Matt Bruck for a while. I said, man, you know, before they turn up or after sound check, can I just, you know, can I have a hack on? Have a hack on the rig, and a hack is exactly what it was. And I realized that, you know, when I got up there and played the yellow one, it was like Music Man EVH, and plugged through the rig, because he had, I think Alex had two quads, Eddie had the three, like wet, dry, wet on stage, plus Matt had two down in the bunker as well with for monitoring. So when you hit it, it came from everywhere. It was like this omnipresent guitar sound.
Oh, amazing.
But it sounded like some drunk Australian playing it.
So you
really loud.
So you played his main.
Yeah.
His number one.
Yeah, the number one.
Mm. That's awesome. Wow.
Caleb's just dying.
Yeah, get up now. Get out of here.
So you didn't think about, like, I'll have him sign it and just put it away. Not at all.
This guitar, well, I asked him to sign it. He wouldn't sign it. He's like, I'm not going to sign it, man, blah, blah, blah. He said, I already signed it. It's already got my signature on it there.
That's
said, no, I need you to kind of, you know, sign it. Ah, forget about it.
Yeah.
It's better to just keep playing it and, you know, have some fun with it.
That's great.
You can't throw things away.
Whack some tens on it that night, because I think he was using 9 or 42 to E flat. It's like really light, man. Everything's, you know.
Yeah.
Just, that's another furphy about, you know, the thicker the string, the thicker the tone, because he's using 9 to 42s to E flat, and that thing sounded immense.
Yeah.
So
He's since switched to a 46. So.
Oh, is he? Okay.
Yeah. But no, it's great. The other questions I had were how long did it take to get comfortable in that slot? Like, you know, if you did.
That's a good question, because some of the shows were less intimidating than others, and depended where we were. Like LA, for instance, was, you know, a whole different audience than, you know, when you were in the Midwest or somewhere. And New York was actually a little more inviting, you know. So it depended where we were, I think, Dave, don't you think?
Yeah, because in the Midwest, they kind of loved it, because it was, you know, the circus came to town. We'd get there early and do maybe a record store appearance a radio thing. And there was a broadcast backstage, and, you know, people threw shoes onto stage.
Mm-hmm.
And they had like a banner with you, and then throwing shoes and hats.
Yeah. We were used to that, because we opened for bands like the Angels and Chisel in Australia. Mm-hmm. And being a female-fronted band as well, people always just assumed, oh, they're going to be shit and they're not going to rock or whatever. And so we were still used to it, and it was a bit do or die every night. It was like we get up there, 40-minute set, you just got to go hard and we just
went
every night. Yeah. I don't know if we ever settled into it. it was never our show. So right. It was always like every night was kind of a, you know, it was a bit of a test and to ourselves, you know, let's just go and tackle and do whatever we
did
need
ever,
to
do. Did you ever catch the guys side stage just, you know, watching?
Did we? I can't remember.
Yeah, Mikey, you usually come up and, or, you know, be down in Mikey world sort of thing, which is over my
Michael
side.
Michael Anthony had a little bar under the stage every night we'd go to.
Of course he did.
During Eddie's solo, which went for 20 minutes.
Yeah.
We'd all go to Mikey's bar, which is a strip of pole and a freaking, you know, a little tiki bar.
Awesome.
Crazy.
Caleb, frozen margaritas. Yeah.
Caleb, I'm going to have to cut it short because I've got a bunch of people lined up waiting to get in, mate. But I'm glad that you came in. So one more time, plug everybody there about your band from your words, mate.
Oh, I'm in a band called Nerd Halen, and it is exactly as it sounds. We play mostly Dave-era stuff. Our singer is Hal Sparks, comedian, actor, and we dress up as nerds. But the band sounds pretty spot on, and it's funny. There's a lot of bits in the show and in the songs. And
well, I'm coming to see you guys next time I'm in LA.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Please. No, it's a lot of fun to watch, but it's even more fun to play, obviously. And I get
tell
to
you what, you know. When COVID's over, we got to get Nerd Halen out to Australia because I think would be huge in Australia. Oh. Hey, you know, there's a tour. Nerd Halen and Baby Animals tour.
Nerd Halen, Midget Kiss, and Baby Animals.
Please. Oh, my God. It was a dream come true. I'm 50, so, like, I'm living my dream just finally doing this because I've been a one-trick guy for so long, and now I kind of found the niche and you know, meet guys like Jason, and Jason hooked me up with EVH. I'm an artist with EVH now. It's just crazy.
Cool. That's actually true. I did help.
That's awesome.
That's actually the truth. I introduced him to the artist relations manager at EVH, who's a friend of mine, and Caleb's now an official EVH artist.
That's so good.
Yeah, surreal.
He deserves it. You know, all I did was say, hey, Mike, meet Caleb, and, you know, he did the hard work, and he's busted ass. He owns the pattern on Nerd Halen and everything. He did it the right way. All right. Caleb, thank you so much for being here, mate. I've got another gentleman named Don DeMoss who's about to come in. Don, make sure that you turn off your sound on your original feed for us just in case. All right, here we go. So, Caleb, thanks, mate. Take care. I'll talk to you real soon.
See you in 2 weeks. 2 weeks.
Indeed. Hey, yes.
Awesome.
Bye.
Thanks, Caleb.
Thank you.
All right, we have our next gentleman coming in. Please welcome from wherever the hell he is, Don DeMoss.
Hey there. I'm from Massachusetts, and Susie, I met you quite a while ago with Paul Betancourt and Paula Betancourt.
Yeah. And
so last time I saw you was in L.A. in 2008 at an extreme show, and you actually got me backstage. And every time I ever saw you, when I was a server at Applebee's, if you can remember that, you were always so nice to me. And so the reason why I wanted to jump into this chat is that I'm super stoked that you got that you're talking about new material. And here in the States, you haven't. I don't think I've seen you guys perform live. And so, if you get new material, is there any chance that you can come back to the States and tour for us?
I mean, we always want to. We really do. It's just there's no label there for us, and so we don't really have, you know, for us to go tour there. It's just expensive to do it, and we work a lot in Australia. I mean, we're always touring here, but I mean, any opportunity, if we got a promoter out there that could, you know, help fund the band to do it, we would do it in a heartbeat, you know, for sure.
Of course.
Just we don't have a label there, so.
We've got to work on that.
What we've talked about is doing it like an Australian invasion sort of thing. We could do a run with like the Angels or Chisel or, you know, Rose Tattoo and do it like that way so it'd be a bit more affordable and, you know.
Package, yeah.
I am sure there are tons of fans here in the States that would welcome you with open arms.
Thanks, Tom. Did you say you're from Cambridge?
I'm in I live near Hudson, so.
Oh, you're a Hudson. Hey, Hudson.
So a little town called Clinton, Mass., so an hour west of Boston.
Yeah, no,
but I lived in LA for almost 13 years and moved back in 2009, so a year after I last saw you.
Oh, right, okay. How is it there now?
Well, I still work in the restaurant business, so I lost both my jobs.
Yeah. Oh, man. So
what I did was I started to invest in myself. I mountain bike, and I want to start up a mountain bike YouTube channel. So just recently got a light and got a nice microphone, and so I look good on camera.
Good man. Good man.
And Jason, your Queen video was outstanding.
Oh, thank you very much. I appreciate that. It was a lot of fun putting. It was exhausting work, and anyone who's seen it knows it was very tough. Because I wanted to build a story. I didn't want to just do a here's another video. I wanted to build a story and have a bit of fun. And then thankfully we had a real good laugh with that one. So
yeah, it was awesome.
I actually did put it to Suze to see if she was interested in being in it, and I just sent her a message on Instagram. And maybe you can be involved in the next one, Suze, because I think we're going to do more of these things. So you haven't seen it yet. So Brian May issued this challenge to fans. He sat there on Instagram and he played Hammer to Fall, great Queen song from the album The Works. I love that song. And he just played it and said at the end of it, play to me, sing to me, drum to me, dance to me, and just put out this challenge. And so all these people were downloading the track and then putting him on the side and themselves next to him and just jamming along. Like I saw one guy was just shredding like crazy, and someone else was doing something else. And look, I'm going to grab it up quickly and show you.
You should, because it's awesome. I don't know how you did it.
Is that the one you sent me, Jason?
Yeah, which you haven't had a chance
to
see it. I know that. Well, that's all right. I'll chuck it up quickly because I want to let other people see it. I've got it right here. I posted it yesterday. So let me think. It's not even 30. Hang on. How long ago was it? It's
getting close to just over 24. No, is it yesterday or the day before?
Yeah, day before. So 48 hours ago. And it's currently sitting at 15,766 views, apparently.
Two views.
Wow.
Three views.
It's been a
bit popular. We've lost Jason. Oh, we've lost Dion. They're both gone into freak out land. He did a pretty smashing job. So while we wait for these guys to come in, we have got a couple of other questions that have come in.
Mm-hmm.
So we've had, come on, machine. No, okay, cool. It hasn't opened up. Kevin Meaney has a little question for Dave. Do you remember the time we left Avalon RSL and we stole the oil from the service station that day?
Stole it. He stole the oil from
DY.
DY. Oh, hey, Kev. I can't just quite remember that. I've only ever stole hearts. I don't think I've ever stole any oil. But,
am but, I yeah, working, by the way?
Yeah. We said we were a band with Kevin's brother, Terry.
Hey, yeah, do you
remember it well?
Oh, sorry.
Go, Suze.
No, I was going to ask Don.
Yes.
If you're in touch with Paul still.
Oh, yeah. Not as often as years ago, but I keep in touch with him. Send him a Facebook message. His birthday was just recently. So
I'm terrible at Facebook. I'm really not on Facebook hardly ever, but send him all my love when you see them.
I will do that for sure. He's making new music, I guess. And so I'm super excited because the world needs his voice.
Yeah, he's got a great voice. He's a funny guy too.
So, Jason, thank you. I'll let you let myself go. And Susie, thanks for chit-chatting for a little bit. And I wish you the best of luck with you and Dave and the band.
Thanks, Don. Take it easy. Right.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Take care.
Yeah.
See you, Don.
All right. Bye-bye. Thank you.
See you, man.
That's super nice of you. Oh,
he's still here.
Talk amongst yourselves for a second while I was quickly reading. So I got a message from Jeff Scott Soto about our Queen video and something about Brian May. Give me one second.
Oh, that takes precedence over this important video that we're doing right now. No problem.
Well, when it comes to Brian May, it does.
Oh, Ryan, whatever.
Ow.
Okay, it's time for me to leave.
So,
Shauna Marie sings. I'm loving this interview. Hey, Shauna Marie. I don't know. There's a lot of, I don't know. I'm sure there's some people on here that we know, right, Dave?
Our audience is pretty passionate.
The strat's going well. Thanks, Watto. It's in an undisclosed location at the moment under lock and key.
John Tide. She's one of the crew, the what do you call them?
The crew, the stalkers.
Stalker crew. Yeah.
As you do. There's nothing wrong with that. Every band needs them.
Everyone needs a exactly. Everyone needs a stalker.
So I'll give you a quick little blast of what we did with this Queen thing, just so you got a rough idea before you get into it. I was quite lucky that I do have a lot of friends in big bands and stuff, and the dude who kind of made this whole thing really insane and work well, I did this. The concept that I ended up coming up with was that it was a dream sequence that basically I had all these famous people that decided to come and do this tune with me, but I saw them all in a dream. So I put it together and essentially dreamed this. So this is me going to bed. And for some reason, the sound's not working. What the hell is going on with this thing? Ah, technical difficulties, my God. Sorry, Dave, you can take that off of me for a second because he's got control over that there, and I'm going to fix this thing up because I think I know. Yeah, I know exactly what's happened. All right, turn off the bloody Bluetooth. Here we go. So one of the guys who's a very, very, very dear friend of mine, and actually you guys might even know him too, I've known him for 30 years, a guy called Simon Croft, who plays lead guitar in We Will Rock You, the actual musical that travels the world. And he appeared in the beginning of the video, and he does a nice, funny little cameo here.
What a great gig that would be.
Oh, tell me about it. I know it's insane that he gets to do stuff like that. And there we go. We've got sound now. It's all happening. Okay. Some rest. I'm exhausted.
Oh, hey, Jason, it's RJ from Hailstorm.
RJ.
You know Hailstorm, right? Hailstorm. We've been around for a little bit. We got that song, you know, the misery and I think we got like 1.something million followers on Facebook. You know, if you know, you can Google me. Hey, look, I heard that you're putting together that compilation of Hammer to Fall, the Brian May video, and it's one of my favorite bands of all time. And I have a drum set at home right here. I'd love to. Okay, you know, it may not be the best drum set, but it's all I have right now. Listen, Jason, we're on lockdown right now. Everyone's in quarantine. I need something to do. Please just give me something to do. Please let me be in the video. Look, before you get hold on, before you say no. It may not be a perfect drum set, but it sounds really great. You want to hear? Let me just show it to you right now. It sounds pretty good.
Good evening, folks. Now I know what I have to do. Okay, this is a challenge. Okay. Jam with me, okay? Let's do this.
So in case you don't recognize the players there, I'll just pause it for a second. The bass player up the top there is Stu Hand that played with Joe Satriani and Steve Vai. The drummer down the bottom is Marco Miniman from the Aristocrats, played with Satriani as well. When Dream Theater did their auditions for their new drummer after Mike Portnoy left, he was in everyone's hearts, the runner-up. He's a phenomenal drummer from Germany but lives in the States now. The guy in the middle, did you recognize the guy on the green tarmac?
Kenny Aronoff.
Kenny Aronoff, yeah. Indeed. I was very lucky that Kenny was willing to come on board. And the vocalist there, that's Jeff Scott Soto, who's from Sons of Apollo and is a really good friend of Ryan's and is an amazing vocalist. That's Debbie Holloway. She's got a voice and a half. And this is Justin Murphy from Melbourne.
Oh, yeah, Justin.
Dave and I used to play with Justin. The guy with the blonde hair is James Lomenzo, the bass player from White Lion and Pride and Glory, and currently plays with John Fogerty. And the other guy there is Buumblefoot from Sons of Apollo, played with Guns N' Roses as well. So I got some pretty good friends who came on board and did this thing with us. So we had an absolute blast doing
this. Awesome. So you approached Brian to do this?
No, Brian just posted this on his Instagram to the world. And all these people were sending in is RJ. He was, for a band like Hailstorm, that's me playing keyboards there. For a band like Hailstorm to have a guy who's willing to put himself out there and do something as funny as that, that was pretty huge of him to do that.
Yeah, it's a heck of an intro.
It's a great intro. He's a character and a half, isn't he?
Certainly is. And so I was really pleased that, you know, all these friends of mine decided, yeah, let's do this for a laugh. And then we kind of broke the internet, and Brian sent back an email that is just to die for with how much he loved and appreciated what we did. I mean, one of the things that Brian said was, I've never felt so honored in my life, which was incredible.
Wow. That's cool. So, I love that.
On the middle bit here, oh, this is hilarious. On the middle bit here, and I kind of want Suze to catch this because I want to appreciate, I want to thank you and send some appreciation for the inspiration here. There are a few bands over the years that taught me how to sing harmonies. I'm not a great lead singer. I'm a terrible, terrible lead singer. But I've developed a skill with harmonies that, you know, I've walked into jam nights doing Bohemian Rhapsody with a band before, and within a syllable, I could hear which part's missing and I can slot into the right harmony. And part of that, the bands that really taught me that was INXS, particularly the Swing record, which just meant the world to me, Duran Duran, who you mentioned earlier, and the Riverdogs, who are coming up on my show next week, and the Baby Animals albums. From the amount of time that I spent listening to those records and the passion and the love for those records, it really taught me the skill of vocal harmony. And for a guy who talks so deep, I was always the one guy in the band that wanted to do harmonies and wanted the band to have them. And I've stretched my voice so far that, like, on a guitar, my lowest note is this B. B. And my highest note is this A, which is kind of ridiculous. But I do that note in this song here. So in this middle section, the absolute top harmony, the Roger Taylor part, is me doing it. The other guys did the other five parts and I put the sixth one on top, and
I just wanted to
thank you, because you guys inspired the shit out of me to get vocal harmonies down, and I'm glad I for once get to actually thank part of the people who inspired that.
We've been given ourselves headaches over those harmonies, I think, over the years trying to make sure
and I know, like, life from a distance, life from a distance particularly, every time that song comes on, I love the way you arranged it, how, like, one voice does the lower note and then stops, and then another voice does the constant note that goes up one and comes back and keeps going again. And the arrangements of those harmonies are just phenomenal. And that inspired the crap out of me as a musician. So I wanted to say thank you for those inspirations.
Thank you.
Here's that section.
Isn't that such a beautiful sound?
So then coming up here, we have the guitar solo section. The first guy is a 24-year-old dude from Scotland named Cameron Brown. He's amazing. Please note, that is a fretless neck he's playing on there. It's a steel fretless neck. That's Buumblefoot from Sons of Apollo, and the next guy will be Alex Skolnick from Testament. Funny thing is, that guitar that I'm using there, my orange guitar, is actually the old model that Alex used to use when he was playing Ibanez back in the 90s. It's my main guitar, so it's kind of a funny tie-in. So yeah, we had a blast doing this. It was a lot of fun. I've actually put out on my Instagram page an a cappella mix of that middle section without all the instruments in the background. I get a little shred on at the end too.
Gotta get ready for your show today. Oh, you missed a call a few minutes ago. Come on, Jason, wake up.
That's my wife.
By the way, you were talking in your sleep. What's an RJ?
An RJ?
So anyway, yeah, we had a bit of fun with it and got a bit silly. I mean, there's a storyline and stuff that goes with it all, and
that's great, man.
Just great fun. So I got to tell you, I don't mean to sell myself here, but I would love to do some video work with you guys one day. Absolutely love to do it. So if you're thinking about doing something, then you know, whether it's a concert video, it's actually my specialty is concert video, even above music videos. Like the last concert video that I put out.
Go to America and do some shows there.
I'd love to come over and do that for you. Like I own 21 GoPros, believe it or not. So I scatter them around the stage and use my other cameras and occasionally use extra camera guys. And my last concert video I put out had 36 camera angles in the one video.
Wow. That's a lot.
Yeah, but, you know, I'm a musician. Like, you guys know, when you listen to music, when you're a musician, you hear it differently than what other people do. You know, it just it's a thing that's inside of you that you feel in a different manner. So now, there were a bunch of other people who messaged me, but I sent them back the link and they haven't come into the chat, so I'm not sure what's going on now.
I don't know, man.
I don't know.
Who's beeping? Oh, it's Dave.
That's just me. I'm getting incoming.
Yeah.
Another question I had to ask, it must have been very difficult being seen as a sex symbol and dealing with people coming to shows and hitting on you and everything all the time. How did you handle that, Dave?
Take it away, buddy.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, it was tough being me there for a few years. That's why I grew my hair really long, so I could just go out and not be recognized, you know.
Did that side of things ever, like, I mean, you're a pretty tough chick, so I guess, you know, it really didn't bother you that much. But, like, how was it back in the day when you guys were kicking off? Like, did you manage to break the mold of, as you mentioned before, it was tough being a female-fronted band. Did you feel like you guys broke the mold and managed to be taken seriously, or was it constant work? Or how was it for you guys having to deal with that side of things?
We never really thought about it very much. We just kind of, you know, the only time we thought about things like that was the videos and doing, you know, promo stuff. The rest of it was just, we just play what we like to play, and we just worked hard on that stuff. And it wasn't like, when I say, you know, being a woman in a band was difficult trying to, it wasn't difficult for me in the sense that I was in a band with a bunch of guys and I was the only girl, and I never felt singled out at all, really. I didn't find that people talked down to me, or it wasn't a case of that. It was just people's perceptions of, you know, when they see a female fronting a band that's opening for a band like the Angels or Cultures or whoever it is, they immediately think it's going to be softer than it is probably. But so in that, I only meant it in that sense. I didn't mean it in, you know, in any other way. It was always, you know, we never really thought about that side of it as much as people may think. You know, it was only when we had to think about, you know, how a video is going to look, or how, you know,
photo shoots and stuff like that.
Yeah, that was sort of it.
I remember seeing that on the documentary about the photographer saying, "Guys, keep moving back
until you're out of focus." But I mean, some of my finest angles are in the out of focus in the background. I'm more than happy to be there.
To be the blurry guy
in the background, no problem, man.
David, can you take over for a minute? Because I've got to go to the bathroom myself. I'll be right back.
Okay. All right.
Wow.
That's always good when the host decides to bugger off himself.
No,
leave me alone. Leave your hand.
I'm going to have to wrap it up soon as myself, because I've got another Zoom call waiting.
Yeah, you're all good. We don't want to hold you through. You've got a life to do. So how are you guys? Obviously, Australia's in full lockdown now. You guys actually in full lockdown, or are you?
New South Wales is still under quarantine. Like, I can only go out for necessities.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So how long have you been? How long has that been running for since?
Been since when the gigs got blown out, which is, when was the last Kiama was supposed to be? It's been since then, really.
Yeah.
So that was a few weeks. Two weeks, 3 weeks?
Three, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Coming up this weekend.
I don't even know what day it is.
3 months.
If that it does, it feels crazy. I mean, we've been in lockdown. I've been here doing this for the last couple of weeks because that's, I don't know, my job's been shut down for the moment, so I can't do and do anything else.
No.
Has it, you know, going stir crazy yet? Are you going crazy? Sort of being stuck in your own four, inside the own four rooms of your house, or you know,
I mean, not stir crazy, a little bit like starting. I mean, you know, I'm bummed that the tour got cancelled. Yeah. And we don't, you know, when you're on a long tour like that, you really look forward to the shows, and you know, it was a really fun tour as well. It was like great, good hang, and everyone was having a great time. Yeah, that was a shame. But
that was a bit disappointing to see that end.
Yeah, it was. But you know, I'm also on my own here. My kids aren't here, so I'm sort of a little bit, you know, it's a little bit quiet.
Yeah, but it's a bit odd.
It's not good. I mean, I've been doing a lot of chatting with people and stuff, which is great. Yeah, so.
And that is, as Jason mentioned earlier, and as you guys were saying, it's a bonus that we've got that technology at the moment that we can do this.
Yeah,
and you can keep in contact with your family and your friends and what you need there as well, which is really cool. Now we do have another guest who's popped into the video chat.
Wonderful,
Mike Robinson. So let's bring him in, and Mike's going to throw his question to you. So here he comes.
Hi guys.
Hey, Mike.
Hi, Mike.
Hey, Mike. What an honor. Love your work, guys. Seen you so many times. Last time was at DYRSL. Susie, you seem to pour your heart and soul into This Is Not the End for probably obvious reasons. Did you write most of that when you got back to Oz or in the US?
Oh, most of it when I got back, pretty much. Yep. Yeah. Dave and I wrote a lot of that up at his place where he used to be up in the Central Coast. And, a lot of it was – well, some of it, a bit of it was back in LA.
Yeah, I think but I come over and visit or whatever. We got a couple of things together. Yeah.
Nice. Really emotional. But love the energy of it. It's when it was released after such a long wait was fantastic.
Yeah. Thank you.
Next one, Home. Who was your favorite duet partner? And why?
Oh, interesting. Home. I loved them all. I can't say there was one specialty. I did love doing Russell Morris.
Nice.
That was a bit of a thrill. I did that whole record with Shane Nicholson, so I loved working with him. He's amazing. You know, he's really fantastic. But that wasn't a favorite. They're all really great. I was stoked to do for anyone. And some of them were done remotely as well. So, you know, we just call in the parts pretty much.
Great. That was my next question. It would have been a fantastic party if all you guys were in the one studio doing that over one day.
It would have been great, but there was only a couple of people that I did it actually in real time, and one was Russell and the other one, well, Shane, obviously, Shane Nicholson. Can't even remember. I didn't even know who else was on it. I can't even think. Like, that's so long ago now.
Tex Perkins.
Oh, Tex, Bungie. Yeah. Tex, great. Tex called it in. Jimmy, yeah. Tex is always great to work with.
Yeah. Fantastic stuff.
A little bit of text.
Thank you. That's everything I had to ask. I've got so many other questions. I could sit there.
You can hit us up with another one. We got time.
Ask Dave.
I'd love to sit at the pub with you. Oh gosh, Dave. What do you ask, Dave? The last memory I have was at DYRSL. I don't have a question for Dave. Just fantastic.
I don't have an answer.
Fantastic. Okay. Blown away by watching you on stage at DY. I was from a camera out, but just fantastic to be that close.
Good
to
you, Mike.
Ripping it so hard, Dave. It was fantastic.
Cheers, brother. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike.
Thanks, and thanks for not having your camera out too.
Yeah, well, it annoys me when everyone else does. So.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. No, modern day thing.
Yeah.
And the worst thing is most people are jumping around like this and their video is going to look like shit afterwards and they just
don't
realize.
Sound terrible too.
Yeah. gone is the moment, the moment of actually that performance. It's gone because they're busy watching through a little other screen on the side, and it's like, eh.
And it never translates. So I've done it a couple of times, I must admit, you know, guilty ZZ Top and stuff like that. But it never, you look it back, you go, oh, yeah, it, the excitement, the whole thing doesn't translate like it did on in the room, you know?
Yeah, it never does. Yeah. There is a question in the chat here. I'll let Mike stick around because he's probably going to want to hear the answer to this question as much as the rest of us. And I wanted to ask this on the show myself. Stephen James, will your reunion doco slash concert ever be released on DVD? And what I would like to extend on that is, will you actually release, maybe it's been and I just haven't seen it, the full concert show of that reunion gig? I've only seen the footage that's in the doco.
We have released that. Didn't we? We did a DVD of the live concert.
That wasn't that live concert. It was the one we did at the Metro as opposed to the one we did for the reunion, which had the two bands, the new band and the old band. I know that Ed Hobbs from Perth filmed it because there was a few cameras and everything, but I don't know where we're up to with the footage and what the intention is to
have a look at it.
Maybe, because it'd be pretty cool. It was a good
if you need an editor to put it together, I'll put my hand up for the job.
Okay.
I would love to see, like, that's one thing. I'd love to see the full show of the reunion of you four guys. It would just be phenomenal to see that.
It was a great night. It was really good.
Ask Dave about his work in One in Seven. What's that?
That was a recording that I did that we did with a bunch of people for prostate cancer, like a tribute.
Right.
What do you call it? Yeah. And we played Turn, Turn, Turn.
Oh.
I played 12-string electric in it and stuff. And that was good. We did that at Ricky Ray's. There's a whole bunch of Electric Mary guys were in it and the Tequila Mockingbird gang, and there's a whole bunch of people, in it. It's good. It was like a bit of a We Are the World type of deal. Yeah.
Wasn't Turn, Turn, Turn one of those like Laurel Canyon creations?
Yeah, I think it was. The birds?
Yeah. Yeah. I'm pretty sure it was.
I got to play Roger McGuinn, which was kind of cool.
Wow.
Yeah.
He's rather epic. You must have been very proud in that moment.
I was indeed. Yeah. Yeah.
Definitely. Well, thank you, Mike. No problem. Well, we've almost hit 2 hours with you, Suze, so I appreciate your time very much. I'm going to let Mike go so that we can wind our show down. Mike, thank you for being here, mate.
Thanks, Mike.
Thanks for popping in.
See you, buddy.
I guess there are other people might have just gotten a little bit shy and didn't end up jumping in. I sent out the links to a bunch of people. Maybe they just couldn't get it to work. Oh, this is a good question, Suze, just quickly before you disappear.
I listened to Nirvana growing up, but I wasn't, obsessed with them like I was more sort of English rock fans. But definitely Chrissy had an influence on me. I can't see how she wouldn't have had an influence on me, in some way. Yeah.
Well, look, I mean, I'm probably going to end this stream and go, oh, there's so many other things I should have asked and this and that and what have you, just because, you know, when I don't script this thing. I never write questions down or whatever. It's all just a case of I like to do it off the cuff because that way you can just let it go wherever it goes. It's not structured. It's just mates sitting around having a chat.
Yeah.
So I really want to thank you both. I mean, Dave, I knew it was easy. I just rang up Dave like, Dave, I'm doing this show. I mean, it was kind of that easy. And it keeps teasing me and telling me I'm going to come to Japan for a holiday sometime soon and we'll catch up and hang out. And he hasn't done it yet, but obviously we can't do it right now.
Can't do it now. But, can't do anything. Yeah.
No, but he keeps saying he's going to come over. So that'll be nice probably when that day comes.
Or maybe and see like, you in NAMM next year.
If there is a NAMM, you know, they've already cancelled the summer NAMM in Nashville this year.
Have they? Oh, right. Okay. Yeah.
But announced a few days ago. So with this whole situation going on, but deeply, I mean, as you've already caught, I'm just a huge adoring fan. I actually, when I saw you guys at the Prince's Ballroom, you guys both signed my original that I bought when it came out, my early warning 7-inch single. You both signed that for me, which is back home in Melbourne in my box with all my classic records. And that meant a lot to me because that single just put me on a path of just loving this band and being inspired. And as I said earlier, a lot of Australian bands were cool, but not enough Australian bands really went balls to the wall, and you guys did it, and I want to thank you as a fan.
I have my balls, definitely have my balls on to the wall, so I don't know about the other guy. But.
Well, yeah, well, I'm not even going to make jokes about it. I'm just going to leave that one alone because I'll get myself in trouble. But thank you, Susie, for taking time out of your very busy schedule. I'm sure you must have right now being locked in a house under the COVID lockdown.
Super busy. Can't tell you.
Anything you want to tell the fans about what you've got coming up with you musically or whatever that you might want to let them know?
We're working on a new record. We've got a stack of songs. We've just got to all – it's probably now that we're not doing shows a little easier for us to be considerate about, you know, time allotment to recording and concentrating on that, because, you know, when you're in the middle of doing shows, it's a bit hard to – get, you know, well, you've got at least 3 days of recovery after the shows to
before you want to start thinking about anything else.
But yeah, new record this year.
I'm gonna try that will be amazing.
That would be incredible. Looking forward to it.
Yeah. Yeah, we are too. Can't wait to actually just get in the studio and start putting some stuff out. We've recorded a little bit here and there, but we need to, like, get that done this year, which would be great.
Love to hear
consolidate
that.
Consolidate ideas, finish stuff off. There's a lot of ideas. We just need to flesh stuff out. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think
that's the priority, yeah.
There you go. Can't wait. Please.
Your mic.
Exactly. There is definitely going to be a lot of creativity coming out of this time. You know, like, it's the one thing. There's going to be so many records coming out and so much of an explosion of music being released. It's going to be a kind of an unprecedented thing, I think, in music history, which is going to be amazing to see what comes out of this.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is. Crazy days.
Well, look, please take care of yourselves, because I think you're both a very, very, very dear and important part of Australian music culture and history and hopefully future as well. And
thank you.
It's just, I'm grateful.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jason.
For everything.
It's very nice. Yeah.
It's grateful to be asked. Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome.
That was really
glad to have you guys become on.
Thank you.
It's brilliant. Well, look, and yeah, all right, I'll let you two both go. Dave, I'm sure we'll speak again very soon, mate. And Suze, thanks again. I really appreciate your time.
No worries, Jason. Thank you. And thanks, David. And thanks,
no worries at all.
Dave. Yeah, thanks, Jace.
All good.
No,
you guys,
my pleasure,
take
mate.
Care. Appreciate Much love. Look after
thanks
yourself.
Everybody for looking
Stay
in.
Safe.
Yeah, thanks to everyone else for writing messages and stuff. I couldn't answer any because you're not allowed, but it's okay. I'll see you.
Yeah.
I've seen you.
There you go. She's seen you. All right. I'm going to let them go.
See you guys.
Bye, Sue.
See you, Dave. See you. See you on the blower.
All right. No worries.
All right, she's gone, Dave's gone, and wow, Baby Animals, that was so good. And I swear to God, I'm going to have so many questions come to my mind after we're done.
Ah, well, email them to Dave, mate. He'll get back to you.
Yeah, of course. Oh, but, you know, I wanted them live for the show. So coming up on the show, as I've mentioned, I've got to shift the Phil-X date, unfortunately, because he had a prior commitment that was just a scheduling conflict, and he has to do the other one. And like I said, I know what it is, and I understand why he has to prioritize that. I wouldn't dare ask him to pull out of that one.
Yeah, fair
enough. So Phil will possibly – I've got to sort out the date with him, but he'll be coming soon. Coming up Sunday night American time and Monday for the rest of us over this side of the world, we have Jeff Scott Soto, Buumblefoot, and Billy Sheehan from the band Sons of Apollo. The very next day, we have Rob Lamothe and Nick Brophy from the band The Riverdogs, one of my favorite bands. I love The Riverdogs as well, just like I love Baby Animals. It's going to be a special one. And if you don't know these bands, tune in for the shows. You might discover some new music that you didn't know about before, and it just might
Absolutely.
Be right up your alley.
Absolutely do that.
Yeah, definitely. And then I've got a few others that I'm trying to sort out for the coming week after that. There's possibly going to be for the Wednesday night for America or Thursday for us, there's possibly going to be Phil-X shifting to that particular spot. What was the other one I was going to mention? We've got the Nerd Halen one coming up on the 22nd for America, 23rd for us. And the entire band, which is going to be fun, all four of them.
Brilliant.
All of you out there, thank you very much for watching the show, for sticking around. Please subscribe to the YouTube channel if you're not already, because the notifications will pop up. Hit the bell for that. The Facebook page is called Live Streams with Famous Friends by Jason McNamara, just what it I happen to call it. But David Birch, I can't do this without him. He may not input anywhere near as much as what I do because I just talk too much. But without him being there, I can't do all my other computer stuff and get everything lined up and get everything ready. And I can't do it alone. So thanks, mate, for being here day after day.
Mate, it's an absolute pleasure. And thank you, first of all, Jason, for you know, asking me on board. But more importantly, thank you guys. Because without you fellas out there listening and watching and fellaresses, because, you know, there's girls and guys out there. Yeah, without you guys being here to watch and listen and sort of jump in with your questions, you know, we're only doing this for ourselves then.
I love how Suze was so blown away by the fact that we had over 200 people watching simultaneously at one time. She didn't expect that, and that was nice.
No, she wasn't expecting that at all, and that is lovely. Yeah. And, yeah, so thank you guys, because, you know, without you guys, there's no point us doing this. So we thank you.
Exactly. I'm going to trail off the end of the show with a little bit more Baby Animals music, and that way you guys can just have something to enjoy while we just finalize what we're doing here. I'm going to pick a random song here from the catalog. Let's go with
that one.
Life from a Distance. Life from a Distance is a wonderful song. This is the track after Because I Can on Shaved and Dangerous. And that's the show, folks. So if you don't already have the albums, grab them because they're phenomenal. I think most of you are going to do it. And also listen to the newer stuff too, because the newer stuff is really good. It just needs people to do what I had to do, which was get over the old stuff to give the new stuff a go. So here is Life from a Distance from the Baby Animals from their Shaved and Dangerous album. And we'll see you all again on the next show. Sons of Apollo coming up Sunday night, American Canadian time, and Monday for us over here.
Can't say that I'm not excited about that one.
It's going to be amazing.
I mean, Colin, honestly, the bass player, that if I had a chance to pick a super band, he would be the bass player all day, every day.
Billy Sheehan. Amazing. All right, folks, thank you. And have yourselves a wonderful day. Be good to each other and stay indoors. All right.
Absolutely. And stay safe.
She's live from the disco. Yeah.